So in this video, we're going to talk about defects and how do we reduce those. Now, defects in the software, just like manufacturing defects, are going to cause downtimes. And this is also, defects are generally in the form of the bugs, application bugs, or some issues or performance issues also in the way the software behaves. And that would sometimes cause downtimes, definitely cause rework, either on the developer side or even on the operation side sometime. And that's where the QA team comes in, and you need some testing to be done before you actually release the product to the production, right? So defects cause waste of time for everyone. It is waste of time for the operations folks to narrow down the root cause, do the root cause analysis, find out whether it's really related to configuration problems, whether it's application bug, and then escalate it to the engineers, and then engineers spending a lot of times doing the rework and fixing the bugs and doing the reissues. Right now, a lot of times developers, majority of the time that they spend is on the rework in the non-performing organizations, and that's a cause of worry, definitely. And that's where we need to start addressing those by implementing or getting immediate feedback, right? And defects also cause firefighting and stress for everyone, right? Now, how do we mitigate those and reduce the number of defects is first doing the test-driven development. That's the development process. That's part of the agile practices. So we're not going to talk about the test-driven development here, but that has a significant amount of influence on the number of issues which get through the development process. Second is the continuous integration. Now, continuous integration is quite important. And why is it important? Is let's imagine this, right? So if you have used the film cameras, you might have seen those film cameras, and those will have rolls, and you would be careful taking the photographs because you would have only limited number of photos that you could take. And it would take a few days for the photographs to develop and be back, and you would really wait for it. And the photograph that you've taken today, you're gonna get the copy of that probably after a few days. By then, you might have even forgotten the way you took the photograph and the impact of, if you have made any mistakes in the photograph, you can't go back and change it immediately. That's very difficult to do, right? Whereas in today's generation cameras, digital cameras and the phone, you can take as many number of photos, and then you get an immediate feedback after that. And once you get a feedback, if you don't like the photograph, you can retake it again, right? And that's where the continuous integration in the software world comes into play, right? It's similar to that. So just like how we get immediate feedback after taking a photograph on our phone, we get an immediate feedback with the continuous integration. And that's where we also start releasing the product in smaller batches, rather than, that's reducing the batch size and doing the just-in-time production that we picked up from the TPS and the lean agile methodologies. Continuous building. So immediately, a part of this continuous integration is you start every time you release a new feature or make any changes, you often integrate it to the mainline code. And then that follows the build process. So you build your software, you test it, make sure everything works. If you have any issues, the developers get to know immediately about the issue while it's fresh in their mind, and they can go make fixes and push that back again, and then make sure the test gets passed. And you can write a test for functional as well as non-functional requirements. Non-functional requirements can be your stress test, security test, reliability, scalability test, and so on and so forth. So that immediate feedback is important, and that's what continuous integration process gives you. So as soon as the developer checks in the code, it goes to the SCM where you trigger the build process, and you send it to or deploy it to maybe a staging environment, and from there it gets cuts to the production environment. That's generally the continuous integration workflow. What are the tools that you would use for continuous integration? You need an integrator. The most popular of that is Jenkins. Jenkins is like the industry standard in the world of continuous integration today. However, there are many other similar tools. Some of those are hosted services, including, let's say, CircleCI and Travis. There is a tool from Atlassian called as Bamboo. There's a GoCD. All of these serve similar purposes. They are the integrators, and that's where you set up the pipeline right from your build to test to running your non-functional requirement test. And when it comes to build automation, again, this is something that developers will start using as part of their agile methodologies anyways, which includes tools such as Maven and Gradle for Java, Rake and Make for Ruby, and rest of the code like Makefiles are quite popular for a while now. And then you have tools like Ant and so on and so forth, right? So you also have tools to build the packages such as Packer. That's your build automation. Along with build automation, you also need automated testing. Now, without automated testing, continuous integration is the fastest way to get a big pile of junk that never compiles or runs correctly. So testing is extremely important, and you need to focus on reducing the number of it's expensive to find issues as you move right side in your workflow. So if you you should find as many issues as possible in the unit test. So what you see on the left hand side is the anti pattern, where you have less number of unit tests, and then you have to rely on more of integration automated tests. Sometimes it goes to the customers, and then you find out. So fixing a issue when it goes out to the customer is more expensive than fixing it in the unit test. So you should shift left, and that's the inverted test pyramid that we talk about. Actually, if I were the one who would create it, I would probably just create a rotated instead of inverted test pyramid, where I would move everything towards left as much as test coverage towards left. That is in unit test, and then we have component and functional test, and then we have the exploratory test on the right hand side, which should just be about like 10% or so, right? So more of unit test and less of right side or the exploratory or UI test and so on. That's how the testing should be, and this is again is goes as part of your continuous integration. So in this video, we talked about continuous integration, amplifying the feedback. In the next one, we'll talk about the deployment and delivery.